teeth. One of the teeth has a small cavity.
Close call, folks, but I think we got here just in time.
Presented by Maria Menounos and Kevin Undergaro. This is Anatomy of a Movie. In-depth discussions and breakdowns of various movie titles. And now that you've seen the movie, let the dissection begin.
Welcome, welcome, everybody. Welcome back to Anatomy of a Movie. Today we are doing the Philomena film today. I'm your host, Marisa Serafini, and today we have...
Hi, guys. Nice to see you, Sara Stretton, today.
Hello, Demetri Panos. How are you?
And we also have Phil Svitek Engineering in the booth today.
Hello.
We really used the word today a lot in that segment, right?
As opposed to yesterday.
Yeah. Tomorrow I'm actually going to be someone else.
Well, tomorrow will be today.
That is true. That is true. So, Philomena, overall thoughts. Did you like this movie? Were you angry with it at the end, where a lot of audience members seemed to had a more angrier reaction to it?
Okay. Well, I think I can answer that question with both, in a way. I really enjoyed the movie. I thought it was very well done. I did leave angry, but I thought that was part of the story, and that was partly because they told a story that has some problems. It's a tragic thing that happened. I saw it in between two of my best friends, and at the very end, I was sitting next to a very strong, like, raised Catholic girl, and also very, both very religious people, and she goes, "I want to burn down the nun's house." And I was like, "You can't say that here." I was like, "That is horrible." And she was like, "It's a metaphor, but I feel it." And I was like, so I was with someone who was very angry, but we all still really liked it. Demetri?
Yeah, for me, I'm going to settle some confusion because a lot of people felt that I may not have liked this movie. See, with me, a common phrase that I use, just so you get to know me a little, if you ever ask me about a movie, like say it was a Good Day to Die Hard. Demetri, what did you think of A Good Day to Die Hard? And I'll say that movie made me angry. And when I'm saying that means that the movie was so bad that I got angry for just being in that theater and like, because it was so bad. Philomena for me is this one exception. 9 out of 10 movies where, you know, I walked out and I tried to say I liked the movie, but the movie made me angry. And some people who, especially my close friends, thought that I hated the movie. It's like, no, I didn't hate the movie, but it made me extremely angry. Mm-hmm. To quote Martin Sixpence or Steve Coogan, and he says this twice in the movie, if I remember correctly, like, fuck the Catholics, fucking Catholics. And that I just kept on saying, like, throughout. And I'm not I'm a religious person to an extent. And, I give people their leeway with religion and whatnot, and that's great. But this was a movie when I walked out and I saw it in October at a convention at the Show East convention, and I think it was the first movie. It was like the movie that they opened up with, and I was with my boss Cammy, who you've seen and met here many times. And throughout the whole movie, I'm just going, "Fucking Catholics!" And she kept on shushing me. And when we got out, I'm like, I am so upset right now. And the movie affected me. And I knew it was supposed to, but I think a lot of it too had to be a little bit of self-introspection as well, because there was no way with what happened to this woman. It was something that I didn't know was taking place. Mm-hmm. And basically this is women who had babies out of wedlock who were living in a convent, basically. If they had this baby out of wedlock, the nuns would take the babies and sell them off for adoption. And the women in question were basically indentured servants. And what they put this Philomena through in trying to find her kid and the lies that they subjugated her to and making her feel awful and not giving her pain medication while going through the birthing process. And it was just a step after step. And when it came to the end and she more or less turned her cheek like a good Catholic is supposed to do.
Exactly.
I thought of a song called Dear God from the Police, in which Sting yells out, you know, how can I turn the other cheek? It's black and bruised and torn. And that's exactly how I felt. I was very angry. It's like, how can you turn a cheek to what they did to your life and the way they lied to you? So it, even to today, the movie still affects me. I didn't go back to see it again. The next morning after we screened it, Kimmy was like, you know, we were meeting up for a breakfast. She goes, oh, did you sleep all right? And I'm like, I don't know if it was the jet lag of that movie, but I'm still angry. She's like, oh my God, Demetrisha. So yeah, but it was well done. I appreciate the comedy elements that were in it. Steve Coogan's writing, I have a newfound respect for that gentleman. Stephen Frears did a really good job directing. So I understand the creative aspects to this movie. I love the performances, but it made me angry.
Okay. Well, I will say, as I was raised Catholic too, I was upset with what was happening and the fact that they pretty much told all these girls that had child out of wedlock that like they were pretty much excommunicated from the church and frowned upon, and were it was beaten into them that like they're shameful, this having child out of wedlock is an abomination pretty much, and that like, in the way that they treated them, it was so low, I guess you can say. But the fact that this was happening and the lies, one of the biggest things that you shouldn't do as a Catholic is lie, and it just the fact that this all happened and they let it happen. And there was no atonement to all this. It just happened and they accepted it. And that's what upset me, that the fact that no one really did anything about it.
Yeah, and you bring up a great point, too, about Catholicism and religion. Like, you know, being brought up as Greek Orthodox, you know, one of the first things, or one of the things you learn is it's about peace, love, understanding, giving oneself, and you're supposed to look at like nuns and people of the clergy, people of the cloth, as people who are that you can go to with a problem, but they're supposed to be people of compassion. And you know, that compassion was out the window. Mm-hmm. And that's what bothered me the most. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the, you know, how can you, with the hypocrisy of it all is why, you know, what really made me angry is that you were being opposite of what
you stand for.
Yes. And that you preach to people on a daily basis outside of Sunday. You know, you're right. It's what you stand for. Mm-hmm. And to treat people like this for a mistake or whatever, and giving birth to a child, like how, you know, you just, and you profited off of it. That's the other thing too. They profited off of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So this wasn't a donation.
And it's
pass out the basket.
It's really different to see what it was like, how the visual and the, you know, the viewpoints of people having child out of wedlock back in the '50s was so frowned upon then, and then nowadays it's more accepted. Like it happens more often, and we're in a generation that we've accepted that, you know, it happens. Mm-hmm. And but the fact that it was so bad, it was abomination, was really upsetting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it makes people were disowned.
Yeah, disowned. Yeah. Even Philomena's family, mm-hmm. she couldn't live with her family because they pretty much disowned her. That's why she went to the convent.
And you know, a lot of that part takes place in Ireland. And, you know, it makes me wonder if any of that was taking place in the States. That was another thing that I was thinking of. Or did they know about it in the States, what was going on? And
well, I think that there's controversy over this. I mean, not only was the story that this book or that this film was like based off of touched on it, but also there's been other books about this circumstance of nuns profiting off of, you know, adoptions or whatnot. And I know that it was linked to, and what I read, it was mentioned Ireland, of course, U.S., right. Mm-hmm. Germany. But there's also controversy because these books are out there, but then there's also members of the church who stand by the fact that no one ever did profit by it and that they were really just trying to help, and that during the time they were giving these women a place to live, and if they had just been in society, their lives would have been much worse. So now that the story is being brought, really, I feel like, to the big screen, to the mass media, but it's crazy. But there still is that tension where no one really is. Sides are still fighting over what's the actual truth.
And it's, you know, it's the same church that hid priests who had relations with young boys. So, you know, I take with a lot of what may have been said pre this Pope, because this Pope seems to be doing some great things.
Pope
but
Francis.
Yeah, but I mean, they've lied before.
Yeah.
So yes, it's
no one
tough.
Wants to be like, oh, look at the horrible things we did.
Right.
Like, if you don't have proof, then might not be like, oh, but think of it this way.
Right.
You know, you have to kind of read in between the lines and see what figure out kind of the truth for yourself. And I think that's what is essential about this movie, is that there are some scenes that had dramatic license to them. They
Definitely.
Weren't directly pulled for the book. They had to change things around. I know two of the points were the fact that Philomena came to the U.S. on the plane with him. That didn't happen in real life. They did communicate through the whole time, but she wasn't there. Also, Philomena's confrontation with the older nun when she was back. There didn't actually happen. She had passed away by that point in real life. But I think that it was this essential truth that they were trying to get at, and I know that's what they mentioned in interviews, was this essential truth. And I think that's what leaves people feeling angry, feeling emotional, is because they were getting that really through.
Right.
And so in that way, they really accomplished, and that's a skill, and they did it beautifully and with sadness and anger and humor.
Yeah.
And that was one of my favorite points of this movie, is that just emotionally, I felt like I was kind of ping-ponging all around. Like, I was literally laughing and then tearing up. And then, like, just almost, like, gripping the armrest, you know. But I wasn't getting pulled out. Sometimes that happens and then I realize it and I'm like, wait, I'm in a movie. Like, this one, I really did feel invested, and it was the balance and the pacing of how when they were adding comedy was really well done. And they also did it in some surprising points, specifically through Judi Dench, I felt like, where they just would add in these key lines that you weren't expecting that just were funny. So I really, really enjoyed that aspect of the writing.
Yeah.
I agree. And you mentioned the writing of this movie, concepted by Steve Coogan and Jeff Pope, who this was the first time they actually collaborated together and worked on a movie and written a full screen movie. That Steve Coogan's comes from more the comedic side, and Jeff Pope was more the dramatic side. And I feel Philomena had a great even balance of both.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I felt that too. And you know, it's Steve Coogan is a funny. He's a funny guy. He's got that dry British wit, which I enjoy watching, and he's, you know, he's funny, and I guess now I have a newfound respect for him, knowing that, you know, he wrote this and he acted, and it's a little bit different for him, but he still had some of that wit about him. And it's interesting, like, how he came about this was partly, he was, I guess, for lack of better words, sort of at a crossroads in his life. He was looking for work, and he had this agent who's trying to get him into these, like, frat house kind of comedies. And he ended up firing this agent, and he didn't know what he was going to do next, but he came across this article, The Catholic Church Sold My Child, and it was written by this Martin Sixsmith, who he had known as a BBC reporter.
He was a BBC correspondent,
And, you know, he thought it was a really great story to try to attach himself to. It's a story he thought should be seen and written about. And so, I think that, he was inspired to go ahead and try to do it. And it took some time to get it onto screen, because, again, it's not the easiest topic to do. You know, when you get a Jeff Pope involved as well, and you pair that together, to your point, sometimes it can go either way. Like, you could have made this, it could have been a broad comedy, or could have come across that way. I mean, it's a road trip movie in a sense. Or it could have been way too dramatic. I mean, as dramatic as it was, it made me very angry, but I was thankful for the levity.
It could have been, yes, I completely understand. It could have been this big, oh, woe is me, huge thing. And I agree with you. This movie really, it heightened my perspective on Coogan. Like, I did think of him as a comedic actor, and this is dramatic. And not only that, but to have written it. And then I really started thinking about it, and I was like, he wrote this movie because he was emotionally affected by it.
Sure.
He knew the outcome. He had such, you know, a feeling towards it and towards what the wrong that was done. And then to be acting as a serious role where he doesn't get that until the very end, like, all the way through, he's pretty much like, oh, I'm a news reporter. I don't really know if I want to be doing this. And then he gets more invested as he goes.
So I was like, that's a lot of layers to work on. Like, you know everything that's happening. You're doing this because you care so much about the story. Mm-hmm. And, like, your background's in comedy. So I was like, that has to be a lot going on in his head and a lot to work through and to be on screen with Judi Dench, who's phenomenal. So I was just like, good job, Coogan. Like, that's a lot of hats to wear.
Yeah, and I think it was smart to make Martin more or less like, he's the character that we're following because mm-hmm. he's the one that's really not religious. So basically what you're doing is you're taking a middle ground character who's not vested in the religion so much. He's invested in humanity, obviously, to an extent. He becomes more invested in humanity. But we see a lot of the story through his eyes. Mm-hmm. And even Coogan himself said in talking with Martin, the actual Martin Sixpence, he had asked them permission. He said, look, I want to make the character in the movie a little bit more cynical and snappier than you. And the real life journalist completely understood and said, sure. He goes, I have, you know, within your boundaries. And he goes, absolutely. So I like that kind of a collaboration mm-hmm. and that Steve Coogan actually had the gumption to ask him to say, hey, look, we have to make some tweaks here and there for this movie, you know, for dramatic purposes. And again, when you're following Martin, because I felt like Martin at the end, he was so angry that he was yelling, like Philomena is like going, why are you letting them get away? Like, you know, they had to sort of like a child send him out of the room. And, you know, and so I think by having him play that character, he's very easy to attach to.
And he also broadens the audience because it doesn't make this, oh, this is a movie for religious Catholic people because that's the story. It does.
It makes it broader.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was also a good choice that they did focus on him and just her instead of doing the entire book, which also follows the story of her son as much.
Yeah.
And they kind of left that a mystery. They kind of took that as, you know, the bare bones. You learn about him as she's learning about him in a way.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a very good choice. And it did have, they said it had to deal with time. And they knew that was a choice from the very beginning to follow her and not him, even though he had such a crazy life and story himself. But that is mentioned in the book.
Yeah, because the book, the actual book, it features more of of Martin's mm-hmm. storyline. He's the central character, and we're in the movie where it's literally called Philomena, and it centers around the woman, Philomena. Mm-hmm. But I loved how Steve Coogan had the audacity to ask that, to change up the character a little bit, because it worked.
Yeah.
Because at the beginning of the movie, we see that he as BBC correspondent, gets fired, and he's having issues with that. It was a very public thing, and so people knew about that, and so it
was controversial.
Yeah, and controversial, and people knew about it, and so it made it more understandable that he might having something being wronged in that way, and then seeing someone else wronged and kind of this is similar, not same situation, but being wronged in a
way by their foes,
by their peers being wronged in that way, he would get upset, and because he knows what that feels like.
Sure.
So it's understandable that he would act out in that way and be more angry and be the voice that Philomena wasn't.
Yeah, and it's one of the funny parts, and it's like one of the parts that had that British wit, you know, when he's seeing his doctor and he's like, well, I'm depressed. He goes, well, you were sacked from your job. And he's like, yes, I know. He goes, well, it wasn't your fault. He goes, that's why I'm depressed. Like, everybody seemed to know that it wasn't his fault for what happened. And, you know, getting back up on the horse again, you know, and being in a sense of voice, because essentially he made that character the voice for Philomena in her travels, and he would go up to the door when maybe at times Philomena may have just wanted to stay in the car or do whatever. And, you know, it was a wise way in which to draw a mass audience in, is to make him sort of kind of like the everyone that you can relate to.
And to put them both in these situations where some could look at it as being both very helpless. Like, they're forced in these situations they really didn't have any control of. They really didn't do anything wrong.
Right.
And they're forced, but they both pushed through. He pushed through and found this amazing story and got, you know, a job out of it. And she pushed through to keep finding her son. But there were these walls that they both broke down. So it was fun to see that and add the comedy. And also his, I guess, he has like a whole work, I guess, transition, but he also has an emotional transition through meeting just her and just through his relationship with her, where he does, I guess, learn to be less angry and more accepting. And just from how you can see it, where she now tells him the whole story about her second novel, which plot is identical to the first novel anyway. So, like, all those little things.
And he goes from being a journalist who doesn't do human interest stories to, at the end, he is a person who is very interested in the human condition. So, and I did find it interesting that one of Steve Coogan's inspirations for writing the movie, what he tried to model it a lot after, was the movie Missing, which I believe starts Sissy Spacek and Jack Lemmon. For Steve Coogan, and it's interesting, he said it showed that the search was just as important as the person being looked for. And this movie, it really is. The search was what was important. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, getting to the end, like the search was getting to that end. And yes, finding the sun and what happened with the sun and all that, but it was searching out this mystery. And yeah, I mean, he followed that kind of plotting. And that, if it had done other, like, if the focus was on searching for the sun, it could have even been more of a letdown, like, knowing what we know now. Mm-hmm. When you find out what happened to the sun, and that happens, what do you want to say, about halfway through, almost three quarters of the way through the movie? It's not like there's still more movie to be had once we
find out the answer that you think this one was about.
Correct. Yeah. And there's still more movie to go. I like that.
That, and I love that, was because that didn't end the movie. It came earlier than we expected, the fact that the son had actually died. And we're like, oh, well, where do we go from here? But we find out Philomena's more motivation is just to see if the son actually had thought about her and thought about Ireland and his origins and where he came from. And that's, I found, really endearing to watch. Right. And it was more than just finding the son. It was like looking at the bigger picture.
Knowing him.
And who he was as a person.
Yeah, and knowing she's a mother, you could understand that, you know, obviously this was something that had plagued her throughout her years.
Yeah.
She never really got over it, and
she didn't get closure.
Yeah. No.
Mm-hmm.
No closure. Uh-huh. And I love the fact that immediately after she had found that the son had died, that she said something like, well, he had a better life. I could have never have given him that kind of life.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So she still accepted it and realized even if she could keep the son, he wouldn't never had the career successful career he would have had.
You just said something that made me think of something, and maybe it was a theme throughout the whole thing, but you know, when you come to the end of this movie, Philomena is more Catholic than the actual Catholics. Yeah. You know, I mean, she, well, you know,
Then at least the nuns.
Well,
like
she could, to have that attitude, like, she never gets to see her son as an adult. Mm-hmm. That has to hurt. But her attitude is, he had a life that I could have never given him. He seemed to have a pretty prestige job, being an aide to the president.
Republican lawyer during the Reagan administration and also George Bush.
Right. So, you know, he had a prestige job. He seemed to be happy in life regardless. You know, it doesn't matter who his relationships were with, but he had a happy time in life. And she admits that she could have never given that to him. So she took solace.
Was very happy also with all of his, like, his life choices. And sure. I mean, she had no problem with him being gay. She had no problem with any of these issues. She was just like, oh, yes, I still love him. I would have loved him to everything. I forgive everything. I'm a happy person.
Yeah, and that's what you would hope. I mean, she, you know, all those years of Sunday school for her sunk in the right way. Yeah. You just wonder that the actual people who are preaching this, that's what gets
them
goat.
Well, it doesn't really make it sound like she's more religious than the other people. It's just she, in the movie, in the film, in the story, that she exemplified more religious traits than the actual Catholic people did. Like, she actually performed forgiveness, which is one of the things Catholics should do, is always forgive, even if they did you wrong and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So
I thought it was a very Catholic pivotal moment. I thought it was a very pivotal moment for her, though, when she did go into the church for confession. At the end, she looked for a confession and then just came out. I thought that was so interesting, because throughout the movie, I did identify her just as being a very good Catholic woman. And at that point where she kind of, I don't know, she had like this turnaround, but still was such a good person. And I still would define her as like a religious character and all this stuff. I thought that was just such a good point to add in, such a wonderful scene to write into this movie. Because it was very unexpected for me. And I just thought, I remember I was just really struck by that moment.
And I loved how you mentioned that, because we see the change of, a little bit change of faith in both Steve Coogan's character and Philomena, because throughout the movie we know Philomena is very a devout Catholic, but throughout the movie she kind of questions it a little bit and realizes things that have been done to her, and then when she went to confessional and just walked out, and she walked out without blessing herself with the holy water, you can kind of see the faith kind of a little bit diminishing, but, and maybe audience are thinking that she's gonna completely leave the Catholic faith, but in the end that she is still a Catholic. And then also with Martin Stacksmith, Steve Coogan's character, at the beginning he tells the audience more times than one that he's not Catholic, he's very secular kind of being. And then at the end of the movie he buys the Jesus memoriam thing, the item
from the nuns to give for
from the convent. Puts on that. So you can see that like the faith change a little bit in the movie, which I thought was really done well.
And to me, I think he was. I mean, I don't know. It almost appeared like he was doing the kind thing for Philomena. I'm not sure that he had a change in his faith. But I think
he was more accepting of it.
He was more accepting of Philomena's attitude, and you know what? Here, I want have this, you know, and this is for you. And, you know, it was, I don't know the guy, but it seemed like internally, he just kept his anger at bay more, and he felt for Philomena, and he welcomed her, like, this is how
her
she feels.
Attitude, and he welcomed her beliefs. It was more about acceptance.
It was about acceptance of her beliefs, and this is her thing. So,
I mean, I think that also, since we've talked a lot about Coogan, we should bring up Judi Dench, who is nominated for this role, as well as obviously the movie has been nominated for the Oscars, Best Picture, a couple others. From rumors, I don't know if this is correct or if this is just gossip, I have heard that this is possibly her last leading role that she's going to be taking.
Really?
Rumor mill says that, according to her, like, she's getting older. She's been an actor for so long, originating on British stage and then really coming over here. And she didn't really become a, you know, Hollywood movie star until, like, her 60s or so, primarily with roles of, like, Queen Elizabeth and M and James Bond and this.
And the Academy Award for being in Shakespeare in Love.
Yeah.
So, and she was in that movie for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And I think that's the one that sort of. Okay. Yeah. Even better. So, I mean, it's funny. Great, like, she was even in the she was in the Chronicles of Riddick.
This is one of her. I feel like this is one of her first leading roles again, quite some time. I would say that M and James Bond is still supporting. They're wonderful roles, pivotal, but they're all supporting.
Sure.
So. But according to rumors, it's because of she's aging, she's having a little bit of, like, eye problems, hearing thing, and I think it's just, it's hard work.
It's
such hard work. It takes so much time. You're working so many hours. So I'm really hoping for her. I think she did a marvelous job. And of the people that are nominated, I would say she's definitely one of the best. And I would be completely happy with her winning for this day, especially if it is her, I mean,
if it is her last one. I mean, she's had an amazing career, golden career. I mean, she's won awards, and she has
in pretty much every avenue, like BAFTAs, Tonys, Oscars, Golden Globes, like, rename the award show, she's got it.
And so even if this was her last film, I wouldn't mind that, because she's done so much, and she's done almost everything that, you know, she can walk away easily
and
if she wanted to.
And she has always continued to do a good job.
Yeah.
It's not, like,
she doesn't have to be a leading role every time.
No, and, you know, you get the cynic inside me. You know, I haven't heard these rumors, but it's interesting that they come around Oscar season. Is it, like, rumor for the Academy, or is it a certain kind of campaigning? Or, well, I mean, you know, even, like, because think about it. Like, you had even said, too, I don't recall her in being in many leading roles. She's usually like a support or something.
Yeah, at least but, in film, like in theater, she's done a lot of leading roles.
And listen, if she wants to take some time off and maybe pick and choose her films, you know, and lighten up the workload, hey, God bless you. You should. You've had a career that most people would be very envious of, and you've done it with integrity. She's a fine actress. And listen, anybody who can win an Academy Award for being on screen for 8 minutes, how impactful is a performance for 8 minutes you're giving her best? I mean, to even be nominated for best supporting actress for 8 minutes of film time, says something.
You guys haven't seen Shakespeare in Love, which is what she was.
It's one of my favorite movies.
It's one of my favorite movies as well. And she does do an amazing job in that film. She definitely sticks with you and is someone you hold on to and remember.
Very memorable.
See that movie as well. It's very good.
Yeah, and she seems to like to be in, like, do these little guest stints. I mean, M for her. I mean, she went throughout the entire Brosnan years, and then
I think she started in 95.
She rebooted, with
GoldenEye. I want to say it was
95. And that was a big reboot for the series, and bringing in a female M at the time was being met with, like, a lot of female M, what? And she took that role throughout all the Brosnan years, and then, you know, with Daniel Craig, where they rebooted it again, yet she stayed the constant. Yeah. She had her character really came full force in Skyfall. We won't talk Sky, you know, but I'm just talking, like, her career is like, she's playing these supporting roles where it's a character that has impact. She was even in the last Pirates of the Caribbean movie. She was towards the beginning of the movie. She shared a stagecoach with Johnny Depp for like 2 minutes. And it's like, wow, she could continue to do that, and, you know, fine.
No matter what roles she takes on in the future, she's still going to have a presence and a following as well, because she has the whole European following, and now she has the American following. Sure. So she's going to go down a legend anyways. Yeah.
And she has a fantastic record, you know, when she's working with the Weinsteins, who love her dearly. And in this movie, you know, she's fantastic. I'm not surprised at all that she would have gotten nominated.
Maybe she could go back to Broadway or, like, the stage.
You know, theater. I think she can go back to her estate, wherever that may be, and just love life, be with her. I believe she's still married. I don't know too much about her background, but she shouldn't, you know, she can enjoy life.
But I do have admired Judi Dench's acting in this film. In this film, Philomena, like, she brought every emotion to...
Oscar worthy?
I think so, definitely. Oscar definitely worthy, but because in the beginning, we started off with her character sad, knowing that it would have been her son's birthday that day. Mm-hmm. And then throughout the movie, you see that she's a happy-go-lucky older woman that you would love to just sit and talk to for 2 hours. You know, you gotta love those older women that just get along with everyone, and she's having a nice conversation with the people who are serving her breakfast. So she is that nice, genuine woman. And then when she goes back to the convent talking to the nuns there, it's just like she brought the whole spectrum of emotions just in an hour and a half.
Yeah, no, she was great. And those scenes that you mentioned are awesome. She'll talk to anybody. There are parts of her that reminded me of my mom. Like, she'll talk to anybody, and no matter where you are, she'll talk to the valet. She'll talk to the guy that's serving you food, and I love that whole when she's in the big city and watching TV. I think I'd much rather stay here and watch this program. This is amazing, you know. And that's really funny. And you're right. She, again, as a great actor, she brought that balance to a role that could have been just played straight, could have been very dour throughout.
Could have been very depressed,
I mean,
sad.
And again, this is one of those movies where, you know, I could recommend to people and saying it's not a hardship to sit and watch it. It's not bleak throughout the entire movie. There are its spots. I mean, look at the poster that they came up with. This new poster during campaigning, this isn't the kind of poster that Mm-hmm. Like, this doesn't even hint that this woman is
yeah. If you're listening on iTunes, we're talking about the Philomena poster that is behind us. It's very bright and it's so much yellow. Cheerful.
Yeah.
Bright yellow and blue and red and stuff. It seems very cheerful in a more comedic way. You
know? And to me, honestly, this poster, which features like the white drawing line and everything, really does seem in a childish in a good way. Like, it's simple and just easy, like, kind of sketch drawn. And very cheerful, which you wouldn't expect from a movie that's about abandoned children or taking, adopting children that
forced
don't want
adoptions.
To. Thank you.
Yeah, and dare I say, it's almost like a marketing cheat. For, you know, we are a new Academy Award season, and for the uninitiated, you know, they might be in a theater, they may have heard of Philomena, they'll see the poster and go, oh, this looks like it could be cute.
And then you come out and you're like,
people might come out, what the hell, that wasn't the Odd Couple comedy I thought it was, but I came out and I learned something, but it was still a good movie. Yeah. I was affected emotionally.
I was too. I think it's interesting, let's talk a little about music in this film.
Absolutely.
Because I went back and I listened to the scores after I go through it, and like I noticed them as I go, this score, when I went back and re-listened to it, was kind of very surprising to me. I was trying to figure out what it reminded me of, and half the songs literally remind me of a more fanciful Tim Burton. It's like happier Tim Burton, but it's very, I don't know, parts of it are like amusement park, and what was that, Phil? Did Phil say something? I don't know. But it's just very, there's these little like dings and frills thrown in some of the songs. It's very interesting. Not at all what you expect. Like, literally, I was like, oh, I'm going to listen to this score, and it's going to be like sorrow and certain parts and anger. And it's so happy. Half of it's so happy. And like, the airport song is like this whole wondrous world. And I'm literally like, I feel like I'm in Disneyland. Tim Burton's around. There's little like dings and chimes.
Frills?
Yeah,
frills. Don't forget the frills.
Frills. There's frills on this music. I'm serious. There's one like called like Amusement Park. I was like, Amusement Park?
Well, the main score for the Philomena movie was composed by Alexander Desplat.
Yeah.
He's actually he's kind of the Hans Zimmer of European films.
Yeah, you mean he's done a ton of stuff and movies.
Lots of big work, like Harry Potter, King's Speech, Moonrise Kingdom, The Queen.
The Ides of March. He did.
He's
mentioned
He's very well known. We don't really think of
Argo.
Him, but he's done a lot of work that we would have never thought of.
Mm-hmm. And that's music to me.
30.
When I think about it, the music's very all over the spectrum, which to me is maybe why I was so surprised by this score, because it wasn't what I was expecting when I listened back. And I could definitely see the Harry Potter influence.
Yes.
In this film, in particular, and Zero Dark Thirty. I'm not so sure. But maybe.
Yeah, and Alexander Desplat has actually, this is his fifth time working with director Stephen Frears. So that makes sense that he would be part of this movie as well, because they've worked so much together. But I like the music. It really reflected the tone of the movie. It was serious here and then fun and fanciful here. And it really reflected the overall theme of the movie.
I saw the movie in October, so, emotion got the better of me, and I don't, right now, like so many months after, I recognize Alexander Desplat, but I'll be honest, I'm not going to make a comment on something that I don't remember. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's either good or bad, because again, for the people who've watched or listened to us, you folks know I am a big soundtrack person, so, it didn't affect me either way. To me, sometimes a score, should accompany the film, not overtax the film. Like, it shouldn't be bigger than the movie itself. Doesn't all the time have to be rememberable. It just has to do its job in pacing and helping to pace the movie. Mm-hmm. So there was nothing that really, for me at the time of watching, that I can recall that stuck out.
It's an interesting balance that music has to play. Yeah. I typically find that the scores that I remember most are for films that have a lot of landscapes or wider shots, because that's where you need typically larger sounding, exactly, or music that gives more of an emotional feel because you're not being carried by dialogue or characters. Mm-hmm. So I think that's why people end up talking so much about, like, you know, the Lord of the Rings soundtrack or these, or Star Wars or anything, because you have these big things to grasp, space or waterfalls or whatnot. And I think that's when you get, you really remember, because then you're thinking about an image tied with music instead of like a scene tied with dialogue. Versus, like, this movie is all about these one-on-one conversations. That's literally, this entire film is just pretty much two people talking. Yeah. You know, you don't have a lot of scenes where you have, like, six characters in a room. It's always, like, two. Even when it's not Philomena, it's young Philomena who's pretty much by herself as well. So it's a lot of it's just, in a way, not smaller, but smaller scenes. So I think that's probably one reason that music kind of, it helps the film, obviously, you need it, but it doesn't, it's not as much of a note when you're thinking about this film.
Yeah, no, and which is fine. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you had mentioned scenes, and I just want to talk about a couple key scenes that I thought were really, really...
Pivotal in this film.
Pivotal, yes, thank you. That really, you know, stuck with me in this movie, that I'd say that the first one, it was probably when Michael was getting taken away. And that was so heartbreaking, because it's so upsetting to know that these nuns, they did let the girls, the women have time with their kids, only for an hour, but they did allow that time to build that bond and that love for the child and to their parent. And then to literally rip that away from them was so heartbreaking.
Yeah, and for Philomena, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, like, if memory serves, she sort of kind of knew what was coming, just didn't know when it was going to come. Yeah. Like, there was that there was that dark cloud because it had happened to other mothers, and she sort of kind of knew that this was eventually what was going to happen, because they weren't hiding the fact that they were going to sell their kids off.
Yeah.
And so when it happens, like, again, she was separated from her kid. Like, there was no easy way for her to run and try to prevent it from happening, and it was a very gut-wrenching scene.
And they also kind of heightened her in particular circumstance, because for the rest of the girls who are also going through this tragedy of losing their children, it seemed like most of them had some sort of also notice, a very quick notice, but it was like, this person's interested, they're coming tomorrow. Wow, great, you get a day to know, but they had that day. And then in Philomena's case, it really seemed like the little boy was a second. They realized that he had such a bond with the little girl, so they had to have him too, but it wasn't planned. So she really had no idea. And I think that that functioned in two ways. One, the audience is like, shock value, it's not coming. Right. Two, it makes it even worse that she can't find him, because we think, like, if she had known, you know, then it's like, why didn't she run away or try and get a chance? It's like, she really had no idea that this was coming, and it was just sprung upon her. So really, it gave you a base to, like, kind of even heighten everything in the whole movie.
No, absolutely.
Because it's always just completely torn. There was always that barrier, that distance. There was no knowledge or no control. Yeah. So whether that was completely factual, I don't know from the book. But yeah, I think it was a good...
Pardon me.
I had read that the mother who went to adopt, went to go look for another child to adopt, had already had daughters that she adopted, and she was looking for another daughter. And then we find out that the two kids, that Michael and the other little girl, that they were always so close, and they always played with each other, that woman was looking to adopt the girl, and then Michael came
over. Was it Mary? Mary was her name, because it was played by the adult was Mare Winningham.
Yeah.
So was it Mary?
I think so. I believe it was Mary, who's the other little girl who was adopted by the same family.
Yes. Yeah. And the woman who was adopting was looking for a girl, and then the boy came over, Michael came over, and then found that their connection as kids were so close, you can't break them up. So she took both of them.
Oh, are you sure it wasn't a 2-for-1 deal at the Convent?
It could have been a discount. Like, buy one, get one 50% off.
Yes, it was very unexpected. But the fact that we had the young Philomena running around everywhere, just all the places where she can see one last glimpse of her son, was it was hard to watch, especially yeah. when driving away. It felt very, very.
And young Philomena was played by Sophie Kendi Clark.
Yes. Right.
And I thought she did a very good job. She has, she's been, I guess, trying to be an actress for a while, but she hasn't had very many big leading roles. So this is kind of a, more or less a breakout role for her. I read that she, on set, was the real life Philomena Lee for the day, for the shoot. And I think it was on, like, the first day she'd ever met her. And she said that that really, I think it was maybe the second take that Philomena Lee, and it really just, put this energy and charge in the dire situation of this scene, because Philomena Lee was crying, and it just made, because she was reliving this moment, mm-hmm. and this made Sophie just so even more emotional, which I think is where a lot of the oomph of this scene derives from. It's just like apparently the whole cast and crew are really just being torn up by watching not only the scene play out, but watching this woman kind of watching her memories. So I think that really, and it came through, and I think that it felt very real.
And also, I think the restriction, the bars actually literally holding her back, that she, because the convent was pretty much a right. day prison for the girls.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And that it just reflected it and showed that she literally had no.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. I mean, control over that.
For me, and I'll talk about Sophie Kennedy Clark in a sec, because I saw a very interesting, entertaining interview with her. But for me, a couple of the scenes. Number one, when they go to New York, I like those scenes because they're humorous. They're good. The scenes with Steve Coogan, again, I quoted that scene with the doctor, mm-hmm. Well, of course you're depressed, you got sacked. Yes, mm-hmm. I know, that scene was funny. But, another wrenching scene for me was, it just, from the beginning, this movie was getting me angry, like when she's giving birth and the nun specifically says, don't give her any no anesthesia.
This is her sin.
This is her penance. But her penance went on until she
was an adult. Her child was coming out breech.
Again, these are scenes like, I always will recount a movie via scenes that stay with me. And those were, that definitely was one. Mm-hmm. Sophie, when she was being brought into audition, she didn't know, at the time she was getting the role, and she was called in, and they had told her to prepare for one scene. Right now I forget which scene it was, but she walked in prepared for that scene, and Steve Coogan says, yeah, why don't you just do the childbirth scene? And it was completely opposite of what she was prepared for. She's like, okay. And so she's like, well, I'm just gonna go for it. She got in a chair, she said, legs up, she just screamed, she goes, I'm just gonna do this, and I'm gonna look at the ceiling and pretend it's all around. And shortly thereafter, she got the role. She was very honored to be playing a younger mm-hmm. Judi Dench. But she said when her scenes were actually filmed towards the end of production. So she was like, pretty much Steve Coogan and Judi Dench had been done. They had brought her in, and she goes, I'm coming into like this. They're already by this time a close-knit family on the set. So I really mm-hmm. didn't know anybody, but they all were very inviting. She said, yeah, of course. She said it was a great, fantastic experience for her. She did very well today. She did a very good job too, I thought, and it's good. It's, you got to credit the casting, because you don't want the physical attributes. You could see how she could grow up to be her.
Yes. So, always good.
I definitely think that.
I would say one of the pivotal scenes for me was actually when we get, you see the turnaround of they've stalked her son's partner all the way to their farmhouse, mm-hmm. and at first you see Sixsmith go up, and he like knocks, and he puts his whole foot in the door, and I love how he did get it slammed, because always it's like people move their hand in time or something, but right. it actually hit, and I don't know why, I really loved that moment. But then on top of that, for then him to move it, then he goes, and then Philomena to go up and really take this action, and like to follow through, like to have made all this progress and come all the way to America and take the flights and to go up there, and then just at that final moment be like, take the gusto to go up and just knock and still be sweet. Mm-hmm. I loved that scene. I loved that turnaround. I felt it was really endearing and really showed a lot about the character growth and just about this story and how much it meant to her and to him. So I, and you just both knew at that point that they were so invested,
yeah,
and they were so willing, and it was even past that drive. They were just going to wait and knock, and it, I don't know, you could just really feel the importance. So I really liked it.
And again, it does show the sort of kind of like the dichotomy between Sixpence and Philomena, because Sixpence, that character, he went to the door and he was
Sixsmith.
Sixpence. What about Sixpence? Tuppence, please. So yeah, Sixsmith. He was still going on like he's being the intrepid reporter. Like there's the, you know, there's the journalistic side, but he's starting to get angry. Like, why don't these people want to talk to this woman? Like they owe her at least that much. And then you're right, when Judi Dench, when Philomena comes up, her attitude is stern at first, but she breaks them down with her kindness. And she's like, I just want to know what my son was like, you know. And yeah, that is a great scene when they sit down and she finally learns about her son. And what we said earlier, this comes maybe 2/3 into the movie. Like, there's still movie to go. Like, in some cases, that could have been it. Mm-hmm. Like, that could have been the end of the movie. We found out the mystery. She's happy. Fade to black. The end. She got everything she wanted to know. But this movie continues to go on because there's still search. It doesn't feel
long.
And
no.
Exactly. Not at all. It didn't overstay its welcome one bit.
And I wanted to... Oh, sorry, Marcel. Oh, did you have another scene? I'll go back to it. Don't worry.
Yeah, okay. The thing I loved about how... about Michael, they built Michael as a character, even though we never see him, he still felt like a central character in this movie too, because we see it in four different eyes, like, yeah, who he was as a person. First we see Sixsmith, when they found out that Sixsmith has actually met Sixsmith, like, he actually met him back in the 90s, and Michael had a firm handshake and he seemed nice. And then we also learned him from Mary, his sister, Michael's sister,
right,
that they're hard childhood that they had. It wasn't a happy childhood, but he did have a successful career. And then we learn it through his partner, Pete, and then that they were madly in love, and then they had a great relationship in life together. And then the partner had fought Michael's personal family, saying going for Michael's wishes to be buried at the convent. And then, because we also find out that Michael did, of course, think of Philomena. And
right.
And I had read that Michael had actually visited Ireland 3 times,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
to visit the convent. And then at the end of the movie, we learn from the nuns a little bit for the nuns. That,
as well as his coworker.
Yeah,
as well.
And his coworkers. That, so we learn it through so many different people's perspective of who he was as a person. And I thought that was a really well done, unconventional way of building someone.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you mentioned something. When they find Mary Winningham, Mary,
mm-hmm,
and, you know, she's like, we didn't have that happy life. That was a nice twist. Which happened to be real life, apparently, but it was a nice twist because, at the very least, because there were such a pair as kids, you would figure, and because these adults who, you know, these people who take, you know, we're thinking they are going off to a better life. That's why the nuns are doing that. But in this case, maybe not so much. I mean, Mayor Winningham or Mary seemed to be a little bit, she had a chip on her shoulder. She wasn't too happy about it. She didn't really want to talk about it and the relationship. And, you know, obviously he didn't have, you know, the father was not accepting. And so it wasn't like the best life, but he did continue to go on and prosper. And he, you know, he was happy and he did. And as we find out, he did think of his mother.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, yeah, it's, but again, it just leads to the lies, the lies, the lies.
All the lies we're talking about, unconventional moments in this writing or in this story, whether it be, you know, that he didn't have a happy childhood or that he was built in an interesting way. I also think it was just unconventional that they did, and they've noted that they built out an investigative journalist to be a positive and kind of heroic, I guess, lead in the story, because the press is always kind of, you know, it's the angry reporters who are ruining the world, and that they did it, and they show that the power of journalism and that what real stories can do, and that's how this, like, the positive side, and why people do need the news, and why things should be more transparent, and why what knowledge can do, and then they're taking this as a platform in real life and positioning it to get actual legislation and things done. Mm-hmm. I thought that was a very nice aspect to this film, that one we don't typically see. Like,
well, yeah. to my knowledge and my limited research on Martin Sixsmith, that, you know, he was a journalist with integrity, and that whatever scandal hit him, where he got sacked from, it really wasn't his fault, but people still looked up to him. And you're right. One of the cool things, it has affected politicians here in the States as well, as Senator Claire McCaskill, due to the real life Philomena and the movie. You know, she's pressing the Irish government to open up its adoption records, because I actually thought that maybe after the movie they would have, in one way, shape, or, you know, that throughout history, but apparently they haven't. And in Washington, a press conference, and this came a couple of days ago, said an Irish government needs to immediately pass legislation to help these children and birth parents reconnect in one way, shape, or form. Mm-hmm. So I still cannot believe that many of these records remain closed, mm-hmm. despite the thousands of adoptions that took place. Yeah. I mean, at this point, why cover it up? Like, to me, it's just, you know, and I know that this movie was the pickaxe, or the pick that just hit that tip of the iceberg to open mm-hmm. everything up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, hopefully some positive comes out of it.
And times were different back then. Back in the 50s, yeah. There was no internet. There was no ways of communication and finding people that we have today. And back then, it was all hard copy paperwork. Mm-hmm. And, of course, those can be easily destroyed, and mm-hmm. no one really knows... you know, had to crack all those cases open and solve every single one of them, even mm-hmm. though there are more cases like this. It's unfortunate that a lot of them probably won't be ever solved.
Yeah, which is very unfortunate. And again, that's another thing that struck me, is that she's one case, but there were so many other women who we'll never know.
Yeah.
And again, you just wonder, and again, the church, the nuns, whatever, they lied to Philomena, they lied to the son. They, you know, they
sent them in circles.
Yeah, just purposely. And again, these are two people who, had they had the opportunity to meet, like, they would have. I mean, you could tell that there was a bond. And if a son who grows up, who really wasn't raised by that mother, and he still wants to know who his mother is, and if you meet the real Philomena, I would say, you know, I think that he would have had the respect and perhaps maybe love that, you know, mm-hmm. that you would have hoped that a mother son could have had. But I think, you know, it would have been nice. But, you know,
well, it's never going to happen. Will be taken. You yeah. never know. It is getting a lot of attention right now. So,
yeah. Mm. And Philomena mentioned that.
Is Philomena Lee or Philomena Lee?
Philomena Lee, the actual woman, she mentioned it's one of the biggest regrets that she never told anyone until so late. I mean, she thought about her son every single day, but she came out with that information too late. Mm-hmm. And then she hopes for everyone else who's now starting to come out with these cases that hopefully they'll have their happy ending.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, you know, people learn from other people's experiences.
But do you, I mean... It's interesting that she says that, and I get it, but under the circumstances, the way that it happened, everything for this particular story mm-hmm. seemed to fall into place. You know, I mean, it was this out of work journalist who was trying to find something. Mm-hmm. He had a potential job, which was a human interest story. He had nothing else to do. So he finds this human interest story to follow it. You know, maybe had she done this some years before, maybe it wouldn't have gone to fruition the way that it did here. And because of that, look at the doors, the potential that it's opened up for other people.
Well, if she's anything like the Judi Dench portrayal of Philomena, she will think that somewhere in her head.
Yeah.
Always thinking that other side. Which is good.
Do we want to talk a little bit too about Stephen Frears and the direction of this movie, which, you know, I think is important between wanting to, you know, mm-hmm. he gives us essentially a human interest story that's a mystery.
Mm-hmm.
it's a mystery about trying to find one's son, about the Catholic Church and whatever. And he does it in a great pace in which, like we mentioned before, the movie never really feels like it overstays its welcome and never feels draggy. I mean, it's not a fast-paced movie, so to speak. However, you stay with it because you want to know what happens at the end.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Stephen Frears, he did The Queen. He also did High Fidelity, which is a really great movie. One of my favorite movies about con artists, The Grifters. If you haven't seen that, that came out in 1990. John Cusack, Annette Bening, Pat Hingle as this heavy. You will never look at oranges the same way again. And, he's a solid director. Mm-hmm. He also did Dangerous Liaisons. So, he can do suspense. He can do this kind of a mystery. He sort of puts it all into this movie.
Yeah.
Period piece.
I would say definitely the fact that the pacing was done so well and the fact that he was combining, this road trip, as you said, story with flashbacks, with another man's life who we don't see. That's a lot to balance. And I think it was done in a good way where we did feel a connection to all aspects. The flashbacks gave us an understanding, a real emotional tie to what Philomena went through. As you said, creating the sun gave us that other side of the book. It gave us what we're looking for. And then on top of it, just all the conversations were well paced. So I think that was really, for me, that's like the gold star of his directing, was that he did add all those components.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And also you mentioned the flashbacks, but also the home videos of Michael as a child. Some of them were made for the film, Philomena, but others were actual real footage from Michael's life, which I thought was great and added more credibility to the story.
I agree.
It really made it real
and authentic. And I found that out afterwards. But it's a nice touch. And, something too that I had read about Stephen Frears, that Steve Coogan and Jeff Pope they were trying to get him as a director. I mean, it was once suggested that perhaps even Coogan directed, but he didn't feel that he would much prefer to act. And finding Stephen Frears and trying to get him to do it. And they were asking him, like, okay, so we have this movie. We know that we can go purely dramatic, but, we want to lighten it up and whatever. And I like this, that Stephen Frears, he said, Stephen Frears flirted with us right up to the wire and gave us good advice, mostly about clarity and brevity. He told us to watch It Happened One Night, and Philomena certainly has a flavor of that, and that's an old classic Clark Gable, Frank Capra movie in which a reporter haps across this heiress who's running away, and it's a road trip movie. And so it's really funny that, Stephen Frears says, hey, watch that movie, and that helped, again, further guide Coogan and Pope to write this script, and Frears comes along, and it seems too that as dramatic of a movie as it was, there was a little bit of levity on set too. Steve Coogan would say of Stephen Frears, he goes, he would occasionally, like, if I was acting too comedic, he said he would wave his hand, which was his way of saying, be a dear and take it down a peg or two, would you please? And then to Judi Dench, he said, like, if he wanted something different for her, he would stop and he'd go, hey, anybody here have Helen Mirren's number? Like, can we get her? Is she available? So I find that funny. And when you're making a movie like this, to recognize, hey, a happy set is a good set.
Yeah.
And so
need that balance, that healthy balance, especially like if you're working on a very serious movie.
Sure.
You need that happy environment to keep going on.
Yeah. So, I think from directing, their cinematography, it looked good. I enjoyed the feel of the movie.
Beautiful landscapes.
Yes.
I always just want to go to Ireland and just look at the beautiful landscape that's there. Because, they travel to America and we're used to those locations that they Washington, D.C. were. But then seeing the Ireland part and all that, it just makes it, it was great spectacle to look at in that sense. And yes, it's traveling, but we see both worlds in this movie. And also the very last scene, I believe, when they're at the cemetery, Michael's grave, and they're outside, and there's snow, light frost on the ground. I believe Frears was wondering how he was going to end his movie, and on the last day of shooting, there was that fresh frost outside, and he's like, all right, this is how we're going to end it.
Yeah.
With that, mm-hmm. the white of everywhere around,
yeah,
which I thought was a nice ending.
Yes, yeah. I agree. I think it's very mm-hmm. fitting. Mm-hmm. That a good job.
Yeah.
So I feel...
Go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
No.
So, I'll, you know, let's talk about the reception a bit. Mm-hmm. You guys were kind of upset in some ways. Other people love this movie. Other people
very upset. Aren't.
Yeah. And other people are very upset. So, mm-hmm. But it's getting great ratings and stuff in reviews.
Sure. Absolutely.
I would say Rotten Tomatoes reception, audience reception as a movie is like very high. Everything mm-hmm. I've heard is just... great reviews. People are happy about the nominations. They're so glad they saw it. Yada, yada.
Right.
Critical reviews or like press reviews, religious reviews have not been so friendly. What I've read, a lot of people talking about how certain people think it's just a Catholic bashing film and it's just...
I've read some
of
that.
Yeah, they say it's anti-Catholic, which I don't really think it's anti-Catholic.
And I don't either.
And being a Catholic myself, and I will say that, and... I feel like they revealed a lot of negative things that were happening within the Catholic Church, mm-hmm. but they weren't bashing Catholics or the religion in that sense.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Just negative situations that were happening.
Well, Catholicism takes it in the chin a little bit. They don't, I would argue that they don't portray, the movie doesn't portray it in a fantastic light, especially when one of your main characters continues to say, fucking Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, they take it on the chin, but I don't think to an extent it wasn't like, I think there was sort of a balance, and I'm going to say that loosely because you had the Philomena character.
Yes.
Yeah.
And because of her character, she lightens that.
Completely.
I think that character lightens it up somewhat. You know, maybe they could have had, one nun at the beginning that sort of befriended Philomena mm-hmm. to an extent, but we never find out about her later on. But, the Catholic Church takes its hits.
I mean, I think it takes its in a way, but I think that's more of just what happened in this scenario takes a hit. Like, this story is not good, so it's not, you can't really put it in a positive light, in my opinion.
Yeah.
But Philomena... and Sixsmith's dichotomy, like their two different perspectives, makes it to me just very, in a way, it ends up being neutral. Because if you changed it and had Sixsmith and Philomena both being religious, then you'd say, oh, this is such a pro-Catholic film, like they all these bad things happen, but look how Catholic we are. Or if you did the opposite and you said it made Philomena have a turnaround completely at the end where she became, she lost her faith. Then mm-hmm. you would say, oh, this is a Catholic background. But they maintain that there are these two people who have these two different viewpoints, and they can still be friends, and they still can, like, understand each other, but they still fundamentally leave with, you know, kind of still their same beliefs.
Right.
So to me, it makes it a neutral. It's a movie. It's a movie about this tragic story that happened, and it's not going, Catholic.
I don't think it's controversial to that extent. I mean... from Rotten Tomatoes, it is very, it's certified fresh. It's 92%. So out of the 165 reviews, 160 or 152 of them were fresh. There were 13, lucky 13 were not so good or rotten, we'll call it. So I don't know. I mean, I think from a critical standpoint, it's done okay. From an audience standpoint, if you look at Rotten Tomatoes, it was at 91%. So audiences seem to be liking it. Mm-hmm. I think what's very interesting about this movie is, you know, we're talking about, you know, acceptance. We're talking about audiences going to it. You know, I mean, I think it should be noted for our conversation that at its widest release, it has only been in approximately 835 locations. At its widest.
Not a lot.
No,
not a lot at all. It is a strict, that is purely that is purely art house, what they call art house fare, an art house platform release. When it came out, it was released on November 22nd, and I believe it came out to 2013. You know, thus far it's made $26 million. So that's, considering it hasn't broken 1,000 locations, 26 mil is actually pretty good. Its foreign and domestic gross now combined is $68 million. So overseas, and I would have to say that a lot of that could be in England,
mm-hmm.
$68 million's, you know, for the Weinsteins, that's really good for a movie that didn't go over 1,000 screens, you know, here in the States.
Do we have any idea about budget?
You know, I don't.
And
couldn't find that out.
Yeah, and yes,
they're hiding it.
There is religion involved in this movie, which I, unfortunately, I think might turn some people off and wouldn't have them go see this movie, so that could have been another factor as well. Mm-hmm. But honestly, I think it's just a story that needs to be told. It's one of those tragic, untold stories that everyone just needs to know about.
Yeah, and it's not a labor to sit through. You know, I mean,
it was a very short movie. I was surprised how short it was.
And it's not. This isn't like the best comparison in the world because the movie I'm going to bring up is another Academy Award nominated movie. It's a very good movie. But like 12 Years a Slave, some people can look at that and say, I don't want to see that. That's a hard movie to sit through. And there are parts of it that are hard to sit through. Philomena, I don't find it to be like that hard of a movie to sit through. No. You know, and the payoff at the end, it isn't so horrible. I mean, you have such good performances. There's enough levity in the movie that for, you know, mainstream audiences, I am going to say, I think the title... Like if you're not educated, you know, the title, like Philomena, what the hell is that? Like that could be something. But again, I think the way that the Weinstein Company released this movie, they've done a fantastic job thus far.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I will say this comment just based on like if you don't know what it's called. When I heard my introduction to this film was, oh, it's about a woman trying to find her son. And then I saw the poster. I automatically assumed he was her son. I did not realize he was a reporter. Right. I was like, oh, it's a woman meeting her son and it's going to be funny. That obviously was not it. It was much better than I anticipated because of that.
Yeah.
I had thought the same thing. I was like, she's going to be looking all along and realize her son's right next to her. But it wasn't that case. But I think the topic of adoption is still really relevant to this day. And especially having the son, Michael, working for President Reagan and George H. Bush. You know, those people are still kind of relevant today. We know our generation knows about them.
Sure.
So, and I think that would really help people understand this movie a little bit more and get the viewers and the audience in the seats as well.
Mm-hmm.
But, and being adopted myself, I found this story really interesting because being on that end, like, you don't think about... I mean, you're always going to think about your biological parents, but you don't think about how it actually happened and the stories that are untold and that we don't know about and like how it actually happened, that whole process. And a lot of people think, oh, it was a happy adoption, but in this case, it really wasn't.
It really wasn't. And again, when you talk about like an importance of story, I can understand Steve Coogan gravitating to it to turn this story into cinematic. I mean, it lends itself. It has all the aspects of making a good movie. You have mystery. You've got drama. You can lighten it up with a little bit of comedy. You have a very endearing character in Philomena. So you have somebody that people can latch on to. And it has just all the elements that would make a good movie. And the way that it was done, yes, it's an art house movie. I mean, for sure. It's not... Mm-hmm. Big commercial fare.
Although I believe they did get the R rating off, correct?
You know, it's funny that you PG-13. Say that because I was just looking up to find out what the rating is.
Yeah, they fought for PG-13, so it had a broader audience.
I want to say I could be wrong. I feel like on its original release, it was an R.
It was R.
And the debate or was a recent change of rating. So I believe in the initial release it was R.
It's PG-13, and the argument was because they said fuck more than once. And I think in the movie they say it three times. And the Weinsteins are notoriously famous for challenging the MPAA and their ratings. And to their credit on this one, you know, I mean, they say, look, it's language. It's not being said derogatorily towards somebody or whatever. It's saying, like, you know, fucking Catholics or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So, and their whole thing is, like the King's Speech, too, went through that arbitration as well. So, you know, and then the Weinsteins credit, you know, trying to get more people, trying to get younger people to come in and see it. I get where they're going with that. You know, but now it's campaign time and we'll see. You know, the Weinsteins are always fantastic at Oscar campaigning, and we'll see how they can do with Judi Dench. They have a marvelous
speaking of Oscars, marvelous they've had relationship a with her. Lot of nominations. I mean, they had a nomination for Golden Globe, but right now we're in the Academy Awards season, mm-hmm. and it's this film, Philomena, has been nominated for 4 different things. 1, Best Picture, 2, Best Actress for Judi Dench, 3, Adapted Screenplay, and 4, Original Score. What do you think of... Do you think it has great chances against the other contenders this year?
I think it's very interesting. I did not know it was nominated for score, so that was a new one for me. I think that, for me, it stands a chance for both Best Picture and Judi Dench, although some people have been saying that it's kind of like the dark horse of X Picture or whatever. To me, I was just like, oh, yeah, it's definitely a contender. Just put it in there. but a score... I think there's better. I do. I'm not saying it's a bad score. I thought it was fun. I thought it was interesting. But I just think that there were some really phenomenal ones this year. So my vote's going to go for someone else. And then the blanking. What was the fourth one?
Adapted
screenplay. I'm going to have to think about that one. I really did like 12 Years a Slave.
With a lot of the films that are nominated for Best Picture have been adapted screenplays.
We talked about that a lot.
12 Years
a
Slave is one of them.
Right.
And honestly, I think that movie has a better chance of winning than Philomena. Unfortunately, Philomena is one of those smaller releases, and not a lot of people saw it as much as 12 Years a Slave.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it was still a great story that no one would have thought of.
Yeah, and I think... Of the nominations, I think its strongest would probably be Judi Dench, you know, would have the best chance of winning. Although, you know, she's in a very tough category this year. We've talked about the nominations this year, and this is one of those years where it's going to really come down to it's going to be very, very, you know, touch and go there until that envelope is open.
Yeah. And then you have to think about it. Sometimes when it does get this competitive, then you have to kind of also think about who are the people, how do I describe this, who have very similar favorite movies, and there's like 2 of them in a way. So if you have 3 top contenders, but the people typically would vote for A or B, then C is going to get it because you're splitting up the A-B vote in a way. So I think she definitely has a chance of winning.
Yeah, I mean, it's her best opportunity. I think it's the movie's best chance overall for winning anything is that actress nod. And again, you know, my years in the business and looking at the Weinsteins and being with the studio that has competed against the Weinsteins for nominations and awards, you just never count them out.
Yeah, and I will say, if this is one of Judi Dench's last leading female roles, I would love to see her kind of end that type of career with an award.
And especially on this movie, which she did such a wonderful job.
Yeah, so it'd be nice to like cap everything on with a cherry on top and get
some
that
sprinkles.
Award. Yes, and all those fun toppings.
And
so it'd be nice to see her get that. But overall, I did really enjoy this movie. Yes, it was a limited release. I had a hard time finding it. I was like, I got to see this movie because everyone's telling me to. But I really have a deeper appreciation for like the process of adoption and like everything that happens in it, because we don't think about that. And I really do feel for all the women that went through that, who had the children out of wedlock and went through that horrific pain and of being separated from their children or even losing their lives, because Philomena says she was one of the lucky ones who actually survived. So I feel for all those girls, and because they were at such a young, innocent stage in their life, they really had no realization, conception of what was really happening. So it's just one, it really pulls at the heartstrings.
Oh, here's a question I wanted to ask you. Because you just recently saw the movie.
Mm-hmm.
You saw it
last week.
Was it crowded?
It was crowded.
It was crowded, okay.
It was a great audience that I was with. People laughed, people clapped, and during movies, and even at the end, like a lot of people appreciated the movie.
But it was crowded, which, you know, yeah, again, when it's limited, too, and a movie like this, and you start at the Landmark, which is geared to those types of movies. How long ago did you see the movie? Do you recall?
A couple of weeks ago,
and mm-hmm. It was crowded. Did you see it at?
I see it at the Sunset, and oh, so okay. I pretty much know how many people are coming in. It's doing pretty well.
Yeah,
it's doing pretty well. I don't think that's it's not. I think it hit its peak already in theaters.
Yeah, it seems to have.
Unless it gets another win, maybe they'll bring it back and we'll go on more. But I think it's hit its peak at least in theater seats.
Yeah, I mean, sure. it's definitely when it was at 800 and when it was at the capacity of 800 plus, mm-hmm. That was definitely in around Thanksgiving time. And once we started going into December and some bigger movies came out, it started to go down 700, 607. Currently, it's approximately or estimated around 500 locations right now. Okay. So, you know, we'll see. Definitely. But, you know, and again,
at least it's getting recognition. For being a smaller yeah. movie, it is getting very recognized.
Yeah, and again, for that kind of for that kind of a release, 26 mil is really good. And again, you got to look at, you know, a movie like Hunger Games or Hobbit, those movies are going 4,000 locations plus. You know, for a movie, and the movie came out in November, where today's the last day of January, and it's still playing around in those theaters. It's hanging on at about 500 locations. You know, hey, it's really done very well, all things considered, in the competitive landscape that it's been about. So you can tell that people are liking it.
Yeah, I was just
sticking around.
I think what I'll just say is, like, my final, like, comment on this film is I thought that it just did a wonderful balance at, like, with your emotions. I think that I'm so thankful that they shared this story with us and that I yes. know, because I feel like this is one of those things that you hope stories don't like this don't get lost. And that's what happened to her for so long until she was able to talk about it. So I'm just so glad that people know. I think it's great that some good could be coming out of this because they are bringing it to a legislative level with this as kind of like, you know, the kick in the pants. And on top of that, I also had a personal connection to it just because I have a lot of extended family who's extremely religious and Catholic, and like my great grandma's a third order Dominican sister nun person, like built like crazy, like mm-hmm. just part of the church. So it was just like very interesting for me to see like this story and to be like, interesting.
So, Demetri, what were your last thoughts on this one?
Well, again, it's I think it's a very good movie. I think it brings to light something that that need to be brought to light. I think it's very important. You know, the other reason too that I wanted to bring up, one of the reasons too that it made me angry was there were a little, towards the end, especially, you know, when I looked at Philomena, the character and how she was turning that other cheek. I mean, there was a little bit of, on my part, self-retrospection, you know, self-acknowledgement. And, you know, I came to the conclusion that I couldn't be so forgiving. Like, there was just no, I mean, after being lied to and strung along and being cheated out of a relationship that you know could have led that could have made so many people happy, I was just angry. And then I became a little bit angry at myself because I don't think I could be Philomena. I don't think I could have that in me to be the woman that she is, which all props to her. That's fantastic. But those are one of the things that the movie brought to light just about myself. Mm-hmm. I, you know, I don't consider myself to be a bad guy. But
you were
I
more
just,
the Sixsmith.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But yeah, because I just knew I wouldn't be able to turn the other cheek. Listen, the movie has an effect. Obviously, we talked about it here. It's a good movie. It does have light moments. It has levity. It's very well written and directed. You won't feel like you're being schooled, mm-hmm. which is important, and you'll come out, you can either come out as angry as me, maybe less so, hopefully to a lesser extent, hopefully you're a better person than I, and there you have it.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's a really good movie.
So great, it was great overall film. I think we're all in agreement to go see this this great film, you know, movie.
Look for your smaller theaters, that's where you're yes. going to find it.
And look for it yeah. out on DVD when it comes.
It should be. I think it's coming out soon. I'm not sure yeah. if before the Academy Awards, but it is going to be available soon.
All right, and where can we all find you to keep any conversation going about films, you know, all that.
You can always like send us emails or post to Not a Movie or Not a Movie on Twitter. All those fun stuff. Also, you can check out our affiliate network we have, which is AfterBuzz TV. Go over to look over there. I've done shows over there. Not in anything currently, really. Coming up with Game of Thrones. So look forward to those podcasts soon.
You can find me here at Anatomy of a Movie. Hey, there's one thing special to note. I think with putting Philomena in the books on anatomyofamovie.com, we have done all of the 9 Best Picture nominees.
That we have.
So, go check us out.
No, we haven't done Blue Jasmine. Is that one of the best?
Maybe we should cover Blue Jasmine. Maybe we should try. Well, it's on Blu-ray. All right, we've done 8 of the 9. Damn it, I thought we had all of them.
We're getting there. But you can follow all of us here on iTunes at Anatomy of a Movie. And thank you for the lovely comments that we got. Someone gave us a nice review about the Wolf of Wall Street and American Hustle.
Nice.
So they loved our dissection.
Where was that found?
That was on our iTunes page.
Sweet.
Right. So please keep commenting and rating. We read all of that. And you can follow us here on Twitter at Movie Anatomy, and then you will see us for the next film.
Awesome.
It's very frilly.
It is frilly and dingy.
Thank you. How was I supposed to describe it?
I feel like I'm
see you next
time. Get us some cotton candy.
Producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the rest of the Anatomy of a Movie staff. We would like to thank you for listening and subscribing to the show. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to email or tweet us. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been Anatomy of a Movie.
Thanks for watching Anatomy of a Movie on YouTube. For more on your favorite movies, subscribe to our channel here, and be sure to let us know what you think in our comment section below here. Bye.